Kenya has put in place temporary measures for its exports to the European Union after the implementation of a duty-free, quota-free trade agreement with neighboring East African countries stalled. Also, Rwanda's central bank has maintained its lending rate at 5% to tackle rising or soaring inflationary pressures and also to aid economic growth. With such pressures happening all over the place in the world of business, finding solutions is going to be very, very key. Welcome to the Business Show. Now, here are business stories that made the Newsweek. Uganda's coffee exports earnings increased to 2.9 trillion shillings. Uganda to produce cooking gas for export. Banking industry players urged to embrace innovation. Ugandans tipped on supply opportunities in the oil and gas industry. And Netflix cuts 150 US best jobs after losing subscribers. Welcome to the Business Show. Now, when the economy was once again reopened after COVID-19, after 2 years of locking down, businesses were hopeful, and especially those that had suffered so much during the lockdowns. But months later, uncertainties continue to rock the markets, including skyrocketing fuel prices, high prices of commodities, and so much more that has led to high cost of operation. This week on Views from the Top, we'll look at possible solutions to this calamity.
So the general sense that so there has been a general sense of being upbeat. The economy has been on a firm road to recover. Of course, it's been slow. Not that we expected it to be any faster, but it's been a slow recovery. But we see certain sectors not at the pandemic levels, but almost there. You know, if you look at the retail sector, if you look at the wholesale sector, if you look at certain sections of the manufacturing sector, those have tended to do well. On the other hand, the sectors that are struggling, if you look at the tourism sector in particular, it's struggling for some time. The education sector was just like a tourism sector, but the reopening of schools was a timely shot that has helped this sector to kind of pick up. So it's a mixed picture, but I would say overall, you see an economy that's on a firm road to recovery, and there's been a lot of optimism. Obviously, we're experiencing some shocks here and there, but overall, I would say that the economy is on a road to recovery, and businesses are similarly learning to cope, and I would say that couple of months or years for some, they'll hit their pre-pandemic level of economic activity. Well, you need to look at the impacts that COVID-19 had. One, you had an impact on supply chains, the disruptions of supply chains, and some firms had to diversify the sourcing of their inputs from Southeast Asia to the region. So that is disruptive and impacts on the ability for these manufacturing entities to operate at full capacity. Similarly, there was also the issue of layoffs. The pandemic led many firms to lay off their workers. So it's not like a switch that once the economy is reopened, you hire everyone again, because demand has to pick up. You can't hire people if demand is picking up slowly. So this really will explain the sluggishness in the sector. There's also been an increase in transportation charges. If you look at freight costs, those are still high because COVID-19 is still affecting certain parts of the world. If you look at China, Shanghai is still locked down. So the freight charges and the ability to access critical inputs are still causing a bit of disruption to certain manufacturing establishments.
Okay, let's talk about shocks now. And within a few months before Kenya goes into elections,
yes.
And we really know that once there is a bit of uncertainty, we're not saying it's going to happen.
Yeah.
But should it happen, we're already seeing fewer
Yes.
Over the, you know, the possible market. So
yes.
First of all, let's start with Kenya.
Yes.
And the elections. Mm. What does this bring for us and our recovery agenda?
So the Kenyan election is an interesting one. You know, when you have an incumbent, it's easy to predict who will win because you have an incumbent with a bit of advantages going into an election. This time you have completely, they are not new players in politics, but none of them has been the president before. So it means that the election is quite contentious, and we've already seen signs that this might be a very hotly contested election. So I would say that Uganda needs to prepare for any outcome. We obviously hope that it will be a peaceful election and that we won't have any security incidents, particularly those that would disrupt our access to the port. But in case that happens, we need to prepare. So it means we need to stock our fuel reserves. It means we need to look at accessing the sea through the central corridor. And we need to look at alternatives, how we can alleviate the potential siege in case the situation in Kenya gets out of control. So I would just urge our decision makers to use this time to plan. It shouldn't appear as if it's a catastrophe, yet it's one that we could have foreseen and averted. Firstly, we have to explain to businesses what's causing this, so they understand, because there's not been much clarity in explaining what is the cause of this current situation. I'd say the current situation is largely driven by external factors. The high price of global crude oil has almost doubled, due, of course, to the disruptions of COVID-19, but very recently, due to the conflict between Ukraine and Russia. So that's one. Two, the lack of planning on our part. We don't have sufficient strategic national oil reserves. So it means it makes it difficult for Uganda to stabilize the price. Yes, even if the price globally of a barrel of crude oil has doubled, however, if we had strategic fuel reserves, would find a way of stabilizing the price on the local market, which we don't have. The other way is that there has also been a bit of cartelish behavior on behalf of some local actors who have sought to benefit from this unfortunate situation. And because we've not been very firm in terms of regulation, it has allowed some of these actors to get away with these kinds of actors. So I think most of the issues are external. There's also some internal components in the problem. But I think it should be able to stabilize soon if all those factors are addressed. Okay. Yes.
So there's this popular talk of the business owners or so employers should look at better payments for their employees, given the tougher times now in terms of expenditure. Mm. Is it something you subscribe to?
Well, these guys need to understand that we are in a capitalistic economy. You know, this is not a socialist republic. You know? So in a capitalistic economy, it means that, first of all, you have to reward the owners of capital. Who are the business owners? So the business owner must get his return on capital because he has borrowed money from somewhere or he has used his own equity to start running this business. So he must get his reward somehow. This is the objective. Now, in times such as these, where the prices for fuel are going through the roof, particularly diesel, it means that the cost of production is increasing. The cost of producing a product or delivering a service is increasing. Now, ideally, the consumer should be charged more, but we know what consumers are going through. Most of them have lost jobs, incomes are unstable, and so on. So it means business owners have to go through a very difficult time to cut costs. Now, one of those costs is staff. And that's why you see a lot of people losing their jobs at this time. Now, those people who have jobs should be grateful to God that they still have them. asking for a salary increment now in the middle of a crisis from your employer will make you a candidate for unemployment, in my view. Not that what you desire is not a good thing. I mean, everyone would want to get a pay raise, crisis or no crisis. But during a crisis, the business owner has to make tough choices, as I've said. And some businesses obviously can afford to increase salaries, some can't. Okay, so I wouldn't really encourage this talk of asking employers to bear the burden of subsidizing the lifestyle of their workers. If government gave tax relief to businesses and urged them to increase salaries for workers, I think this would be an excellent move, but that is not the case. So businesses cannot be expected to bear the brunt of such crisis. So my view, therefore, is workers should be more understanding. It's difficult because inflation is a tax, not just on the business owners, but also on ordinary employees. You know, because what you used to, if you bought 5 bunches of matoke last month, with rise in inflation, it means you can only buy 3 or 2. You know, so it means you're losing money somehow. You're losing money. Okay? So it's a tough situation, we understand, but we need to see how employees and employers engage in a more, what can I say, bit of dialogue and understanding to get through this crisis. And trying to use unions and apply pressure to increase salaries, I think, is not, would not be the best way forward.
As you come to an end, we had from government in 2022-2023 that we don't have new taxes.
Mm.
Is it something that creates a bit of, you know, hope or a bit of relaxing for the taxpayers?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good thing that, you know, if government keeps introducing taxes every year, you create a very unpredictable business environment. You know, when investors or business people are planning to choose, they come up with, are choosing which place to invest, they conduct an assessment. They conduct an assessment of the taxation regime. They see which taxes you charge, you know, they look at your corporation tax rate, they look at your pay-as-you-earn rate, they look at your VAT rate, and then they choose to invest. Now, if each year you keep throwing a new tax in the mix, it means you're creating a lot of instability. Okay? So it's a good thing for our taxes and our tax regime to be fairly predictable. So the fact that government is choosing not to introduce taxes, I think, is a good thing.
Thank you for watching The Business Show. We urge you as a business person to remain in position, looking out for opportunities as you've realized that what we expected after the opening after COVID-19 is not what we're receiving. But should we give up? Of course not. Let's take a break now. But when we return, we shall look at some of the things you can do, especially when you've acquired a big sum of money that you weren't expecting.